Like most people my age, I have a spot right around here. It's a vaccination scar. People born after 1972, they don't have one because by then, smallpox wasn't a problem. Even when I was a kid, smallpox wasn't much of a problem in the United States, and now it's been eradicated from the world. How that happened, how we got rid of one of the world's most dreaded diseases, it's a fascinating story. And it's a story that Dr. Michael Kinch wants us to remember when we talk about the current debate over vaccines. He's Associate Chancellor at Washington University and an expert on drugs, medical innovation, and public health, and quite a historian. He's written Between Hope and Fear, A History of Vaccines and Human Immunity. He's a man of science and frustrated by what he considers the flimsy, even fake science behind today's anti-vaccine movement.
Are you on a crusade to straighten things out in your mind?
I wouldn't call it a crusade. I think really the purpose is to convey to the public the reality, the truth behind what is out there. Scientists, I believe, in general, have done a rather poor job of communicating the opportunities around science. In writing this book, part of what we realized is that the current anti-vaccine movement, which happens to be against measles, mumps, and rubella, the MMR vaccine, is just a recurrence, a flare-up, if you will, of something that happens periodically every 10 to 20 years. And that is that there'll be a new vaccine, it'll be introduced, and the initial reaction by the public is generally fear. And actually, the results that have led to the current fears of the measles, mumps, and rubella vaccine, the MMR, is not only based on little data, it's actually based on falsified data. So I was actually dissuaded from writing the book early on.
Yeah, you're not supposed to be an activist. You're supposed to be a scientist.
Absolutely.
Let other people be activists.
Absolutely. And when I floated the idea off of a professional colleague of mine, whose expertise is vaccines, he said, don't write this book. We all know that the anti-vaccine movement is trivial and that it's been disproven again and again. There's no reason to do this. You know, it'll basically be a waste of your time. But the reality is, if you look at immunization rates and you look at the impact of the decreasing immunization rates, especially here in Missouri, you see the fact that we're losing this fight. There are more people electing not to get vaccinated. There are states like Texas who recently decided that it was going to become basically vaccine optional. California's had a very similar law in place for a while. And what you're now seeing are wherever these laws are adopted or these rules are eased, you're seeing an increase in the morbidity and mortality, the death and disease from preventable infections.
So how do you answer a question like this? I'm concerned, I've been reading on the internet, it's not just the individual vaccines, but it's the group of vaccines mm-hmm. coming at a particular time. Is there a way to put my mind at rest? Are there other options?
I would say the best thing to do when you have concerns is look for credible sources. Don't just look for volume of sources. And the example that I give is that if you go onto Twitter and type in vaccine, the few times that I've done it, it's about a 5-to-1 ratio for anti-vax, because it turns out the anti-vaccine movement is very highly organized. And then they have some very convincing looking documents. But if you look at the information behind those documents, it's sparse if non-existent. And again, there have been many studies with hundreds of thousands of people that have been performed to show that vaccines are safe, that vaccines don't have any link to autism, and that basically the risk both to yourself, your children, and to society from not becoming vaccinated is very high.
But the interesting thing about the anti-vaccine movement is it's not coming from, well, people who are uneducated.
Actually, it's the inverse of what you would think, which is that the wealthier you are and the more education you have, the more likely you are to reject vaccines.
Is this part of the movement of sort of holistic, natural health, you know, letting your children play more in the dirt? There are natural ways to immunize yourself against these things, and maybe science is pushing, or the pharmaceutical industry is mm-hmm. pushing things, when we can find our solutions in healthier living mm-hmm. and natural immunizations.
And I think that's part of what drives them, them being the anti-vaccine movement. The issue with that is that unfortunately you can't necessarily determine when you're going to be exposed to a pathogen, to a virus or a bacterium.
What's the problem? Can we zero in on the idea that I'm making, for example, a lifestyle choice? I'm going to mm-hmm. have this healthy lifestyle. I'm going to project this and all of that. Mm-hmm. What's the danger in people choosing that lifestyle to the rest of the population?
So, and specifically rejecting the vaccine.
Vaccines,
the
sure.
real danger is that now you are going to bring that pathogen that perhaps you say, it's okay if I get infected or even if my child gets infected. You're going to now be bringing that pathogen into exposure with other adults and children that are perhaps not protected because they're immune suppressed. The elderly is an entire population that is immune suppressed naturally with age. Likewise, the very young are very immune suppressed. So you're now risking exposure to these other children and adults and elderly people of potential death. And so it's a choice you can make, but you're endangering others.
So I grew up at a time when I had mumps, I had measles, mm-hmm. I had chicken pox. What was the problem with that? I mean, you know, I'm fine, right? And I had all these childhood diseases. What's happened?
Well, first of all, you were lucky because oftentimes measles, mumps, or rubella is deadly. And actually, it's fascinating to both look through history, because I think I'm a frustrated historian at heart, and look at the number of adults who lost children to measles, mumps, rubella, and other childhood diseases. So to a degree, you were lucky. To a degree, you were also lucky because you had access to good health care. Not everyone everywhere has that. And so a disease that's preventable through a vaccination is infinitely better to be protected than to have to go through that disease.
Mistakes have been made
absolutely
over the years with vaccines, whether yes. they were the people who developed the vaccines or mm-hmm. the manufacturing of the vaccines or side effects that people didn't see. Those are very real.
Absolutely. Yeah, there have been many, many cases of mistakes being made. Probably one of the most famous examples was with the polio vaccine. The gentleman who introduced it, whose name was Jonas Salk, when Salk made his initial announcement, they rang the church bells all across the United States. It was a radio broadcast that was most people in the nation listened to. Within a year, it turns out that a bad manufacturing batch on the West Coast led to many children being immunized with a vaccine that hadn't been properly killed, and the consequence was it caused polio in many children. That happens, and that has continued to happen. Thankfully, we have good diligence for the most part that identifies potentially toxic vaccines and withdraws them from the market. But unfortunately, like anything, there is always an inherent risk.
That's what I enjoyed about the book, because I liked the history. And you dug into, very often one name is what lives on
yes.
for great discoveries. And you've at least given some credit to the people who were making contributions or inspiring or figuring it out, and then nobody realized they'd figured it out.
Absolutely. And that's part of both the problem and the opportunity. The opportunity is obviously in writing books like this, rediscovering some of those individuals. And it turns out they were real people. They had personalities, sometimes good, sometimes bad, but they were real people. But also part of it is that we've forgotten about diseases like smallpox, like polio, that we've essentially been able to eradicate and remove from our visibility through vaccination.